On this episode of Cuesta Dose for March 9th, 2020, my brother David and I talk a little bit of Brooklyn Nets with the firing or the mutual breakup of Kenny Atkinson and the Nets head coach. Jim Dolan, owner of the Knicks, and how he's just kind of a big baby. We talk about the key NFL free agents and pick out the ones that we think might have the most impact and where they possibly could go. We stick on the subject of free agents, but we talk about the Jets, who they need to bring in, who they should be looking at, who they are looking at. We talk about the UFC card, the Adesanya versus Romero card, where they were the headliners. And then we talk about NCAA March Madness looming its head, who are the favorites for us, who are the sleepers. And there are two New Jersey teams in, Rutgers and Seton Hall. So without any further ado, enjoy the show. What's going on, sports fans? Welcome to Cuesta Dose. I have no idea why I did the intro that way. I'm Alex Cuesta with my brother David Cuesta somewhere in the swamps of New Jersey. What's up, Dave?
You're really going all out for this intro, huh?
Hey, figured gotta spice up every once in a while, right? Gotta do something different.
That's definitely fair. It's fair.
Maybe give it a little country accent here, and do a little something.
Giving the piney accent.
That's you now. I'm not a piney guy anymore. I'm a Mid Hudson Valley dweller.
You're always a piney.
Oh, speaking of Mid Hudson Valley, interesting. I don't know if you saw this because I made a big deal about it. So over here in Po-town, Poughkeepsie, New York, they're doing, we have the walkway over the Hudson. It's like a big, mm-hmm. big deal here. Mm-hmm. They're doing a 1 mile race. And my beautiful wife, Julie, pointed out, I'm in the promo picture.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
And I was in great shape. That had to be sophomore year of college. The beer gut isn't there yet. I'll take that picture, walkway. Thank you. Thank you for the flattering picture. I appreciate that. It was a good time.
Nah, they didn't care about the picture they chose. They just said, oh, look, two kids running.
Yeah, they saw a kid wearing Marist track and field gear, and they're like, oh, cool, runners. Anyway, we're going to get on with the show. First, Dave, I'm not happy.
I know you're not happy. It's just understandable, completely understandable. It's not like I'm happy either. I'm just trying to figure out what went down. I'm not. I'm actually tired. But
daylight savings time out, sucks.
Yeah. Trying to figure out what went down, though, with the Nets. if anyone follows basketball, even if you don't care about the Nets, you probably saw the news that Kenny Atkinson was fired.
But, Dave, the Brooklyn Nets don't matter. What they do doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's true. Whatever. But, yeah. No, Kenny Atkinson was fired, which surprised literally
mutually
everyone.
Parted ways. It mutually doesn't say parted he was ways. Fired. They mutually parted ways.
I mean, whatever way. He's off the team. Whatever way you put it, he's off the team. So it took everyone by surprise, no matter who it was. No one really saw it coming. Maybe you could say, oh, he might not be there next year. But no one saw it, like, this late in the season, almost into the playoffs. So there's a lot of stuff coming out, a lot of things just being thrown out there, and we kind of got to wade through all of it to see what might have actually happened here, even though we may never get the full answer. I'm going to let you go first because I know you have a lot to say on this, and then I'll put in my two cents.
So my first reaction, I don't know if I want to put explicit on this, so I'm not going to give my true reaction. First reaction was, what the hell? What is going on that this guy that we've had help turn the Nets around from a absolute dumpster fire to a respectable team is out? And for me, one of the things that I turn to is he developed how many guys, David? How many guys? He developed Spencer Dinwiddie. He developed Joe Harris. He helped develop Caris LeVert. He turned Brooke Lopez into a three-point shooter. He did a lot of things for the Nets. So for them to mutually part ways, now you'll touch on a lot of the other things. I'm just kind of giving my first reaction. One of the things that came to mind now is the Nets have to win a championship with this next coach. There isn't there is no more fun time with the Nets. It's over. The whole entire cutesy, gritty team that was there and fights hard and seventh seed, and that's done. That's it. With KD and Kyrie and this next coach, if the Nets don't win a championship, all the gains that they have made with getting fans to come over to Brooklyn to buy into their quote-unquote culture is gone and could set the team back another 20 years if a championship doesn't come into Barclays Center. You have more, Dave, and you don't feel as strongly as I do. So what's up?
No, I feel strongly. I really wanted to see Kenny Atkinson coach this team next year. I wanted to see what he could do with it.
Mm-hmm.
But like you said, it's all for naught parting ways with him if you don't win a championship. I mean, mainly I see it as you have to at least get to the finals multiple times, be a perennial powerhouse in the playoffs.
And no, become, Dave. There is no, none of that. You have to win, period. Oh, right.
You have to win. But this is like the
Warriors dissing Mark Jackson. Exactly the same situation.
Somewhat. It's not the exact same. It's somewhat. We don't have a Splash Brothers. But yeah. So when you go through everything, it was true that it seems like it's a mutual thing. It seemed like Kenny Atkinson didn't want to coach there anymore. And I know I'm going to say it's because of KD and Kyrie, but it's not like, oh, they pushed him out or anything. It was because his coaching style doesn't fit with the way this team seems to want to progress. His coaching style really fit for the way that we had to play to become a good team in order to get that 17, in order to be a really gritty playoff team, in order to develop these players, because it's a very equally distributed amount of touches for the offensive players. That's what he's trying to do. That's why he was able to develop so many players, and he did extremely well. Like I said, I still want to see Kenny Atkinson coach this team. But it seemed like the styles are starting to clash, and that's why they made this move. And it's definitely interesting. You're going to have to win a championship here to make you seem smart, to make it seem like it had to happen in order for us to take that next step and stop being that gritty team that, oh, you know, we're going to give them a fight, but we're probably not going to win, to we're a perennial powerhouse. We're coming in to kick your ass, and we're coming in to get a chip. So we'll see if that happens. We'll see if that next coach can do that. But, I mean, Mark's, I'm assuming, he's going to make a lot of moves too, because Prince has very well underperformed this year. Mm-hmm. We've had Wilson Chandler hadn't even looked that good. We have multiple vet players that are just not playing as well as we thought they were.
Yep.
And, I mean, we're not even seeing Rhodey in the lineup, which is one of the weirdest things that has happened this whole year, because every time Kurucs has been in that lineup, he seemed to have been a revitalizing factor, and we just don't play him. That's one of the things that's really blown my mind, either with Kenny Atkinson or Jacques Vaughn, even just the first game back.
Yeah. You know, one thing I do want to call bull on is the whole entire his style clash. When Kyrie was there, Kyrie was dominant, and Kyrie was the focal point. There wasn't as much ball movement. It was Kyrie's offense, and there was not a sign of, Kenny's trying to hold Kyrie back. No, Kenny kind of deferred to Kyrie, and when Kyrie Irving was there and healthy, we saw a different Nets offense, and I don't know, Dave, it was a worse Nets offense because he wasn't really gelling with everybody yet, but it was very Kyrie dominant. So I kind of call bull on this. Well, he was, and maybe behind closed doors, he was really pushing back against it. I don't know. But when Kyrie was healthy in there, it was the Kyrie Irving show. And rightfully so. Kyrie Irving played great, but it wasn't Kenny's offense when Kyrie was there.
Yeah, well, and that's the whole thing. It's probably behind closed doors, he's pushing against it. And you could see, like, during that offensive period when we did struggle is because that play – the way these superstars like to play, mainly most of them, is they're going to get their touches. And if you're the guy that's running off ball, you get an open shot, you better hit it. Like during the beginning of the season, Joe Harris was gotten into a little bit of a slump, so that hurt our offensive prowess. Yep. Caris LeVert was hurt, mm-hmm. which is always a bad time for our team. Spencer was the only one that seemed to have stepped up when it was able to make plays when Kyrie couldn't make plays. And then when you saw Kyrie get off the floor, when Kyrie was hurt and off the floor and everyone got more touches, when you put up more shots, you become in more of a rhythm, and that's how the offense flows more, especially when you can get the ball around. But that's more of Kenny's style, and Kenny liked it. And I don't think it's going to work with Kyrie and KD both on the floor. They both want their touches.
Yep. We'll see how it goes. We'll see what's next. We'll definitely, especially as Nets fans, keep an eye on the search. Some of the names that have been floated around, I think, are a little ridiculous. I don't see a coach out there, personally, Dave. Ty Lue has been floated, and he's gone.
That was BS. Ty Lue was a BS report. And I didn't believe it for 1 second.
A potential reunion with J-Kid, I don't see. I've seen Becky Hammon's name floating around, and Becky Hammon, but...
They're just throwing out any name they can think of right now.
And Dave, I'm putting this out there about Becky Hammon. I don't really know her as a coach, but if she was next, why did Pop pass her up with Timmy Duncan the other night? Just throwing that out there. Becky Hammon should have been the head coach in Pop's stead if she was ready or if they believed in her. So, just throwing that out there. We're going to move on, though, to someone who I don't think anybody believes in. Jim Dolan. Owner of the, I'm going to say Rangers and Knicks, because he doesn't get the title of having the Knicks first. Dave, has there ever been a more insecure owner in all of sports? And we're talking Jerry Jones, Jim Irsay, other owners. This guy is an absolute clown. There is a Snapchat video of fans chanting, sell the team, sell the team. And mind you, the Knicks team is a dumpster fire. And no one's yelling at the players, who are terrible. They're yelling for Jim Dolan to sell the team. And he promptly had these guys kicked out. Oh, and he had an incident with their biggest fan of all time, Spike Lee, who refused to get off an elevator.
That was the biggest incident that I wanted.
And those are the two big incidents that, Dave, what is Dolan doing? And honestly, I always talk about how idiot the Knicks fans are. I think they've had the worst 5 games in attendance in like 2 decades so far.
Yeah, they're really getting fed up with that. I think the Spike Lee thing is going to be, it might be the straw that breaks the camel's back if James Dolan is to sell the team, mainly because this one really confused me.
Hold on, wait. I'm not selling anything over Spike Lee. I'm sorry. It might be better off without him there. I don't know. Maybe I just don't like Spike Lee as a fan because he's a psycho.
No, you just don't like Spike Lee as a fan. See, my thing coming at it from a business perspective is this man, known celebrity, everyone knows Spike Lee. This man comes to your games
religiously
all the damn time. Yeah. He is your biggest fan. If you ask who a Knicks fan, who is the biggest Knicks fan, you'll probably say Spike Lee.
Yeah, probably.
You'll probably say him. They went through the math, I think, on First Take. They said he spent around $10 million out of all of his time going to Knicks games. I mean, that could be off. That could be completely off, but it's definitely in the millions how much he's gone to Knicks games. And you're going to get into a whole gripe, little argument with him because he was going in the wrong entrance? What? I don't get it. I don't get it. Even if Spike is like lying about some things, even if they weren't actually allowing people through that employee entrance, it's Spike Lee.
Yeah, he should be able, you know, if anyone ever watched.
Let him in and say, okay, listen, man, we love you. We're going to let you in, but please, please, please take the other entrance next time. Just do that.
If anyone ever watched Entourage, where Ari Gold yells at the guy and says, you know how much I pay for these seats, I'll jump on the court and take a three if I want. Spike Lee's that guy.
Exactly.
Spike Lee jumped in, had the ball passed to him and drained the three. They would count the points. That's how often he's there.
That's the whole thing. That is one of the most surprising incidents I've ever seen. I just don't get it. If it was a regular Joe Schmo that was trying to get in through that entrance, no one cares about that guy. Maybe it's his first game. Maybe it's his fifth game in like 7 years. No one cares. Like, yeah, that's a little annoying, but whatever. It's Spike Lee. If you're doing that to your biggest fan.
Courtside season ticket holder.
Exactly.
Forever, since we've been alive.
Exactly. If you're doing that to him, what does that say about the rest of your fans?
So, you know, like I said, I think it's like a 5-game skid where they have had attendance dipping. Still really good attendance. I say it again. Knicks fans, Dolan is your fault. You are the, for some reason, you are the richest franchise in Forbes again. It's your fault. Stop buying jerseys. Stop buying hats. Stop buying shirts. Stop going to games if you want him out. He'll sell if he doesn't make any money. That's it. That's it. You know, every time it all goes back to that. We can talk about how much of an idiot Dolan is all the time, how he spits in the fans' faces, basically, how he doesn't care what they think, yada, yada, yada. David, all boils down to he's laughing to the bank every single day. So there it is. Knicks fans, I say it again. Don't be stupid. Stop going to games. Stop buying Knicks stuff. Don't give Dolan any more money. And that is it. That's it. There's really nothing else to say there.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie. I'm really hoping things get better for the Knicks because it's just kind of annoying seeing them in the news for, like, this nonsense. Like, I'd rather see them in the news for doing at least something good.
Oh, yeah. They got a new team president. Did you know about that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Who cares? Same old. Who cares? That's our transition. Who cares about the Knicks right now? Everyone cares. They do everything. They notice. Yeah, we notice they're dumb. Continue.
Alrighty then. We're going to move on to something that I don't think you feel as strongly about, mainly because we don't know exactly what's going to happen. NFL free agency.
With a lot of people and a lot of teams.
A ton of people. This might be a very big free agency. NFL free agency is going to be starting March 18th.
A little bit.
Yeah. Very soon, March 16th is like legal tampering period, so we're going to see probably a lot of news start coming out.
Which, I have to make a comment about legal tampering. Teams cheat so badly that all of these leagues had to go,
yeah, I know.
Guys, I get it. This is when you can start. And teams still do it. I guarantee they're tampering now.
Oh, 100%. If you don't want a player enough to cheat for him, then he's not going to want to be on your team.
Like, the fact that there's a quote-unquote legal tampering is not a positive word. It is a negative word. Tampering is a nice way of saying cheating. It's legal cheating. We're allowing you, like, I don't know why they have an official day and a tampering day, quote-unquote. They should just be all year. Who cares? Just all year, talk to them, sign them. Steal them from other teams. If two owners want the same player, octagon it, and whoever wins gets that player. Like, that's it. Legal tampering is the dumbest thing in sports. All right, go ahead. Continue, Dave.
All righty then. So I'm going to go over, like, position by position. I'm going to go over their names quickly. Not every single one, but ones that stand out.
Everyone. Even the guys in the XFL that are eligible.
Not every single one. There are probably some XFL people we'll see in the NFL next year. But I'm going to start off with the quarterbacks. Obviously, the biggest free agent of all quarterbacks is Tom Brady. No one knows what's going on.
I thought you were
going
to say Jameis.
Yeah, Jameis. Jameis is actually going to be a pretty big one. He got LASIK eye surgery.
Future MVP.
Exactly. But no one knows where Tom Brady's going. I'm kind of sick of hearing all this speculation. I still think he's going to end up back on the Patriots until he's in another uniform. Then after that, they have Drew Brees on here. Brees is back. I don't know why they still have him on here. It was updated today still. I'm going to skip this name, and I'm gonna ask you who I missed at the end of this, because I don't understand why no one cares about him. But next is Case Keenum. Then Marcus Mariota, Josh McCown, Dak Prescott, who's going to get his deal. Or at least
he just got a new offer contract today.
Yeah, there you go. Phillip Rivers. Don't know where he's going to go. That's an interesting one. Ryan Tannehill, who might stay with the Titans if they don't get Brady. And, of course, Jameis Winston.
Okay.
Now, Alex, who did I miss?
I don't know. Who'd you miss?
Eli? You don't know? You don't know.
Eli retired.
Teddy goddamn Bridgewater.
It's because he was third string last year.
He went 5-0.
I agree, but then they brought him the third string the moment Drew Brees came back. Taysom Hill technically jumped him.
It's nonsense. The Teddy Bridgewater is going to win with your team. I don't get why people disrespect him so much.
Because at this point, he's a stopgap.
It's honestly just one of the most... Everywhere he's gone, he's performed well when started.
David, I like Teddy. You know, I was on the record saying I wanted Teddy to start for the Jets. I was okay. If we didn't draft Darnold, I was okay with Teddy being the guy because I believe in that kid's talent. He's a stopgap quarterback right now. The injury was horrific. No one believes in him. And it's an unfortunate thing that he got tagged with, that he is officially going to be the veteran stopgap. He's going to be Jeff Garcia. He's going to be John Kitna. He's going to be those guys who you come in, they win you games. You know who's a perfect example of him too? Kyle Orton. They're going to win you a bunch of games, but the moment a shinier toy comes, you're dumping them. Kyle Orton won some games.
I know, but it's all these really,
guys were successful guys.
It's extremely annoying, man. It hurts. It honestly does hurt because there are quarterbacks being talked about in free agency right now that are not as good as Teddy Bridgewater. They simply aren't. It rags on me. But anyway, I'm going to move on. So, running backs, we have Amir Abdullah, Peyton Barber, Kenyon Drake, Melvin Gordon. Derrick Henry's still technically a free agent, I guess. He's going to be back.
Derrick Henry ain't going nowhere.
Exactly. Jordan Howard, Carlos Hyde, Wendell Smallwood, who's made some good plays. Lamar Miller, who used to be a very good running back.
Yep.
Next, we're going to move on to wide receivers. Nelson Agholor, who might be memed out of like any starting
just by Eagles fans alone, and the guy helped him win a chip.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But, hey, man, we'll see what happens with him. Robbie Anderson, who's asking for a lot of money, and I hope he doesn't get it, mainly because I want him back. I'm sorry, Robbie, but I want you back, bud.
Wow, he hates you.
Travis Benjamin, Randall Cobb, Amari Cooper, Devin Bunches of Funches.
Who is a legitimate number one now after the year he had before, you know, him and Jameis had a connection and Cam Newton turned that man into a number one receiver.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he's pretty good. Josh Gordon, who should be extremely upset right now because I'm pretty sure they're looking at marijuana as like legal soon in the NFL. So Josh Gordon should be like punching the air right now. Shard Higgins. Emmanuel Sanders is apparently a free agent. He's a very, very good veteran presence on your team at any time. Tight ends, a very short list. Eric Ebron, Hunter Henry, Austin Hooper, and Jason Witten, who's still playing because he can't commentate.
Why is Hunter Henry a free agent?
I don't know, but he won't stay. He won't quickly. Stay free agent. He won't stay. Tackles, Brian Bulaga, Jack Conklin, DeMar Dotson.
Jets are looking at hard, Conklin.
Conklin, yeah. Guards and centers, Glasgow, Ronald Leary, Brandon Scherff, Joe Tooney, who also the Jets are looking at hard.
Mm-hmm.
We have some defensive linemen here. Michael Brockers, Damon Harrison, Gerald McCoy, Leonard Williams, who might get franchise tagged by the Giants. We'll see. Edge defenders, we have Vic Beasley, Shaq Barrett, Jadeveon Clowney, Dante Fowler, who seems to always be a free agent, Everson Yannick Ngakoue, and a couple more that I just didn't want to name, but there's a lot of good edge defenders out there, honestly. Linebackers, we have Corey Littleton, Blake Martinez. Blake Martinez is a big one. Joe Schubert, yeah. Tahir Whitehead, Alec Ogletree, and Danny Trevathan. Cornerbacks, we have Prince Amukamara, Eli Apple, James Bradbury, who Jets are looking at, Rashad Breeland, Darquez Dennard, Kendall Fuller, Chris Harris Jr., Byron Jones, and
I believe the Jets are also looking at Byron Jones.
Logan Ryan as well. They are. Yep. There are a ton of good
Logan free Ryan, Rutgers, baby.
Yeah. There are a ton of good free agents who, even some I'm not naming, like, I still wouldn't mind having on the team. Safeties, we have HaHa Clinton Dix, Carl Joseph, Rodney McLeod, McLeod, or however you say his name, I'm sorry, Demarius Randall, Jimmy Ward. There's a ton of good people out there in free agency. Out of all those names, who do you care about the most?
Putting aside Tom Brady, because he's not fair.
Everyone cares about him.
Tom Brady's out of that mix. Who do I care about the most? Honestly, I know we've been joking about it, but my top one has to be to see where Jameis goes. Because all jokes aside, he is a potential game changer. Wherever he goes, if he goes to a quarterback needy team, he can do some big things if he has some weapons and some time, and now he can see. So those are all big factors. Who else would I like to see? I would like to see where Dante Fowler goes because he can be a factor player. He's a little undersized, which is his issue, but he's definitely a factor guy. And, you know, also Hunter Henry, I mentioned him. Why is he even a free agent? Why was he not just re-signed?
I think he'll be. These are kind of free agents in name, I think he's going to be signed.
Yeah, so he's a guy that if he's you know, on the market, any team would benefit from getting a Hunter Henry, especially with the way the tight end has evolved. So, Dave, do you have any guys that stand out to you?
Well, other than my absolute seething rage about Teddy Bridgewater, Blake Martinez is a really interesting one. Blake Martinez, I'm pretty sure, led the league in tackles last year.
I think the Eagles are looking at him.
Yeah, they should. Any team should look at Blake Martinez.
Except the Jets, as long as Mosley and Williamson are healthy. We don't need him.
Other than that, I mean, I'm not entirely sure. Kenyon Drake should be still with the Cardinals. It would be interesting to see where Melvin Gordon ends up.
It would be. It definitely would be. Yeah. You have anything else on specific free agents there?
Not really. Most of them, I mean, I will be surprised when things start actually getting going. But other than what we've seen here, I'm not entirely sure where most will end up.
All right, so quickly, since we did touch on some of the guys the Jets are looking at, we mentioned some of the free agents. We're going to talk about some of the Jets rumors. Trumaine Johnson is out long enough. It took too long to release him. We knew he was going to go. He had to go. I talked to Big Joe Hackett Sr. on the show this past Wednesday. We talked about True being out. And, you know, it's sad because I forget what guy it was on Twitter. It's one of the Jets beat writers. They said he's probably easily the worst free agent signing in history, and it is probably true. And I always feel bad for players when things like that go down.
Yeah,
because he didn't come in here going, I'm going to mess the Jets season up.
Mm-hmm.
He came in here working his ass off. He had a little bit of an injury that slowed him down. But, you know, he came off being a very good corner, probably thought he could make a nice impact. He had some really good safeties behind him. He probably thought he was going to have a very nice few seasons and have a good Jets career. So it's unfortunate it didn't work out for True. I wish him nothing but the best, but yeah, it was a terrible signing. Absolute terrible signing.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate. I mean, we gave him this big signing.
Yeah.
We thought he would at least be decent. At the worst, he could have been decent, but he was just not good.
So does it scare you that we're looking at guys like Breland and Jones, and Breland's going to have another big number? That's a big number cornerback that's not super consistent. Byron Jones, same thing. He's not going to be chump changing. They're both guys that are very prone to giving up the big play. They make great plays, but they do give up big plays.
Yeah, I understand that, but I'm going to trust in Joe Douglas for right now. I think he's more focused on the offensive line first, and then he's going to move the corners.
So are you paying Conklin? Because Conklin's going to be the highest paid. Again, I was talking to Big Joe Hackett Sr. on the show this past Wednesday, and he's right. Conklin's going to demand the highest price tag for all of the guys there.
100%.
Are you willing to pay him franchise left at Nate Solder type of money?
Am I?
I mean, not you. You can give him like 70 cents a minute.
Yeah, exactly.
An hour, not even.
I mean, maybe, honestly, because if we don't have a sturdy line, then we're just going to end up ruining Sam Darnold for anything he could become. So if we can do that, I wouldn't mind it. I mean, we can get wide receivers in the draft. You can get corners in the draft, and you can still make moves and get decent stop gaps. I mean, our defense still played well with corners that no one knew the names of. So the offensive line is the number one priority here. So if you're going to spend money, I'd rather you spend money on something that's going to improve our running game and our offense as a whole.
Yeah, the two positions that I know everyone says, like, you know, corners are terrible and they're not great, but I want to see an edge rusher. If Joe Douglas doesn't spend big on Conklin but decides to spend big on an edge rusher, I'm okay with that. The Jets have not had an edge rusher since Sean Ellis and Johnny Abraham.
Yep.
It's been that long.
Yep.
So the Jets need an edge rusher in the worst way. So say he whiffs on Conklin, gets another guy instead, and then spends big money on a big-name edge rusher that's going to get us 10-plus sacks a year,
mm-hmm.
A-okay with that.
Yeah, I'm perfectly fine with that. There's a lot that he can do, and I'm interested to see what he will end up doing and what he will end up getting. I just hope he doesn't flub it. I'm going to trust him for right now, but if things start looking bad, I'm going to get a little upset.
Don't get upset. Don't get mad. Get glad.
That's fair. It's very fair.
All right. I'm good on the Jets, Dave.
There's only so much about the draft.
You know what? Part of me wants to talk about the draft, but I'm not gonna lie, I didn't pay attention to the combine. And we have the 11th pick, which is limbo. It's really well. The combine's useless. It really like the more I think about it, the more I watch. I used to like it when I was younger. It was cool. It's like an all day affair. You're watching guys do things that have nothing to do with football.
Yeah, I mean, you're just watching how athletic they generally are.
Cool. Really and how many of the great, great athletes?
Oh no, I know. I'm just saying that's all you're really seeing. Like you're not seeing entirely what goes down to make a great football player, but you have to see where they're kind of at athletically, depending on what you need. But I mean, it's not the biggest determination. Tape says all. It's the tape that says the most of it. It's just you got to see where they're at right now.
Well, speaking of the draft, then, who do you want to see the Jets take at number 11? Do you have a guy in mind?
It all depends on free agency. If Joe Douglas whiffs on the offensive line but ends up getting like wide receivers, corners, edge rushers, I want to see an offensive lineman. Wirfs is pretty good. He's a monster. I mean, you have Makai something. I can't remember his last name for some reason. But you have a bunch of good offensive linemen. You can pick a number 11. If he does build the offensive line in free agency, which is his number one priority, I think he's going to get that. I wouldn't mind seeing Jerry Jeudy. Honestly, I wouldn't mind playing around with Ruggs, seeing what Ruggs can do if we can get another if Robbie, especially if Robbie stays. I mean, I think Adam Gase might be able to do a lot with him, but I wouldn't mind a good wide receiver as well.
Quick question outside the draft. What do you do with Quincy Enunwa this year?
I think the Jets are going to stay loyal to him. I think we're going to see how he does with his injury. I think we want him back on the field, see where he is at, see how he can play, because we know he can be dynamic. It's really sad seeing how basically his whole career has just been one injury after another. But they're going to stick with him, see how things work out. And I think if it doesn't, if he just cannot play, they're going to have to let him go. But if he can, they're going to want to try to fit him in the system and get him going.
I would love for the Jets to tell him, we're going to honor your contract. Go home. It's neck injuries, dude.
I know.
It's neck injuries.
Oh, I know.
We're going to honor the rest of your contract. You're forced retired. We're not letting you die or get paralyzed. Because I only see the worst, especially with the way Quincy Enunwa plays. He's so physical.
Oh, no, I completely understand, man.
And for me, it's like the last thing I want to see is this guy not moving on the field, because this is his second neck injury in so many years, and it's taken him out for two seasons, basically.
Mm-hmm. Listen, I understand, and for the most part, I'm there with you, but like, it's hard to look him in the face and tell him that, listen, your passion, your heart, everything that you're putting into this rehab, we're not going to let you go out there and do this to yourself. It's hard to do that to some. You know how much they want to play this game. I think at least seeing where he is and what he can do, you got to give him that service.
If he's healthy, he's our number one receiver.
Yeah, probably.
If he's healthy, he's our best receiver. He's our best weapon because he can play tight end. He could do H-back. He can run out the backfield because he has hands like Wayne Corbett. Like, they're that, like, good. Mm-hmm. Like, he's our best receiver, but I'm just concerned for the dude's health at this point.
No, I could care less
about football when it comes to Quincy Enunwa.
No, I understand. I'm just looking at it from what his perspective probably is, because leading a career full of injuries, you're going to feel – it's going to be a depressing attitude unless you can get back on that field.
All right, so that's my draft choice. Have Quincy sit down, Quincy Enunwa, and force retirement.
That's a good draft choice. Good draft choice.
That's going to be spend my whole, if I'm Joe Douglas, I'm just sitting in the war room with Quincy the whole time. Like, he's like, man, we're going to do a draft. No, Quincy, we got to talk. But you got to draft someone and you're up. I have it on auto draft. That's not a thing, Joe. We're good. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry. The Madden simulation.
No, Madden.
Just fine.
I automatically set it up. It'll pick who's there. Joe, you're picking a kicker. We
best
need one.
Available.
We need one. We're good here.
We're going to aguayo ourselves.
Oh, no. We know.
All right.
We picked Nugent one year. He was terrible.
All right. We're going to go from something I hope isn't a sad end to something that was a sad end. Now, I don't believe you watched any of this.
No.
No. So there's going to be a lot of me talking. But the Adesanya versus Romero fight that I've been hyping up happened.
Oh, speaking of, I did see a meme where it was said, like, when you and your friend are first playing a game and trying to figure out the controls.
That. Mm-hmm.
Was that the whole fight?
Basically, honestly. I'm not gonna act like it was any better than that, really. So I'm going to go through the whole card. until I get there, so I can give you the good point. Because this would have been a fantastic pay-per-view, and like Dave, a main card that you watch.
And this, things like that is why I can't get into UFC. If that was the fight, this is why I'm more of a boxing than UFC fan. You don't see that in boxing. You see guys hitting each other. You see a lot of hugging in heavyweights, but you never see the sizing up of two styles that clash. All right, go ahead, do your thing.
I understand that, but okay, let me get through the card.
Yeah.
So the first fight, he had Alex Oliveira against Max Griffin. Mm-hmm. Fantastic fight. They were beating the hell out of each other. Blood everywhere. It was a great fight.
Very nice.
Oliveira ended up winning. Fantastic to watch. Entertaining throughout the whole thing. Next fight, I don't know why I'm losing my mind on this. I don't know. I can't remember who it was. Oh, my goodness.
Do you need me to look up the card, Dave?
Matt Nagy versus Lee. I don't know how I forgot it. It was a good fight. Lee had a couple of very good hits on Nagy, but his length and reach just ended up destroying him. He was all over him by the end of it. So, yeah, we saw Nagy win. Then third fight, Beneil Dariush against Close. It was the most of that fight. These guys are big guys. They can throw punches. By the end, like the last 20 seconds of the fight, you basically saw them say, okay, one of us is getting knocked out. they were trading.
It was like an agreement that they didn't have to say. It was just like, we're both exhausted basically. Here. Someone put the other one down.
Basically. Dariush got rocked. You thought he was going down. Then he ends up advancing, attacking. Fantastic knockout. Close's mouthpiece came out a little bit. If you look up that knockout if you can, because it was awesome to watch.
That's great.
So that was a great fight. So the three before the co-made events, great fights. Mm-hmm. Then you had Wei Li versus Joanna.
I heard the women stole the show. That it's oh my god, fight of the year already.
One of the greatest fights in UFC history.
Yeah, that's what I've heard, is that these two women put on, and not even just women, these two fighters put on a show for the ages.
Yes. If I'm gonna ask you to watch a fight in recent history, watch that one. Watch that one. You can see why this is why you might need to watch UFC, because you never know when you're gonna get that kind of stuff. I mean, I thought that was gonna be a great fight in the first place.
You did hype that fight up.
I thought Wei Li was gonna end up like taking Joanna out, but they went all five rounds. Both of them took shots that, my God, like how do you not go down? Like they didn't even fall. And it was, you could see at the end of the fight, you may have seen a side by side of Joanna
before her face and after. Was mangled.
Oh my God. Like they went through hell. And it was fantastic to watch. I wouldn't mind seeing a rematch in the future if Wei Li keeps that title, which I think she will. But that was fantastic. And you know, we always go to the duality of man with Jameis Winston, and that's what we saw here. We saw the first main event, one of the greatest fights I've ever seen, and probably a lot of people have ever seen.
Yeah.
One of the most boring fights you'll ever see. So, Israel Adesanya versus Yoel Romero, basically, it was Yoel Romero trying to catch Israel Adesanya, trying to get him to really attack and advance on him in order to hit a big counter. Very little did Yoel Romero advance. When he did, he had a takedown. Adesanya got up immediately. He had another, I think he may have two, where Adesanya got up again. Very little did he actually advance. He did have him on the cage at one point. Almost looked like it might have been TKO. Adesanya got out. Yoel went back to that style. I don't think you could really score it for Yoel at all, because maybe the first round, Romero gets it. After that, Israel actually threw punches, actually threw kicks. The leg kicks were devastating. By the end of it, every time Romero got hit in that leg, he crumpled a little bit. You could see it. You could see that he was actually getting hurt on that leg, and you could see that he couldn't stand too well. If he took many more, he was going down.
Yeah.
So it was really annoying to watch. If you watched any of like the Adesanya fights with Gastelum and Whitaker, you saw those guys advance a lot. on Israel. And they took a lot of shots. But like I said, Adesanya does have knockout power, but he's going to tag you a lot more and he's going to knock you out.
Yeah, he's going to wear you down.
Exactly. And Yoel Romero, you are a tank of a man. I just don't I understand that's a style to get you with it. But sometimes you need, because Israel's not going to come at you crazy if he knows what you're going to do. That would just be stupid for him. Like, especially against you. You have the knockout power and explosiveness. Some of the best out of anyone in the UFC.
One thing that I'll never understand is when you are a challenger fighting a champion,
you need to beat him.
You know, you need to beat him outright. That's one thing that John Jones has lived off of is that he doesn't get beaten outright.
Exactly.
John Jones has lost fights as a champion, and there is no doubt that he has lost fights that have gone the length, but because it wasn't decisive, he retained the belt.
I guarantee you right now, a lot of people say Dominic Reyes won that fight against John Jones, the most recent one he had. And
Alexander Gustafsson a few years ago beat the crap out of John Jones, but because it wasn't convincing, there was no real knockdowns.
Yep.
They gave it to Jones. And Jones is a great fighter. Don't get me wrong. He has the belt. He earned it.
Oh, I know.
And you need to beat a champion outright. You can't be tentative against a champion. It doesn't work. Champion reigns.
The saying goes, if you want to beat a champ, you got to beat the champ. And that's why I didn't understand Romero's game plan coming in here. You are a behemoth of a man. You are a freak of nature in every single positive connotation I can put on that. Because his explosiveness, his ability to just move, it's terrifying. And for you not to press more, for you not to really make those advances to get in there and get at him, I understand Israel is a slippery fish. She can get out of a lot of things.
Yeah.
But you can move, man, and you could really get in there. There was maybe like 50 punches thrown in total. Like,
you know, the bottom line combined. Is, if I'm looking at it and I'm Romero, and the only injury sustained is me limping out of the octagon, then I didn't do my job. If Adesanya's not really hurt, if my body isn't really hurt besides me limping out of the octagon, I didn't do my job.
Yeah.
You know, like, at least lose a fight where you fought.
Yeah.
Don't lose a fight because you didn't fight.
Mm-hmm.
So, those types of main events, Dave, and it sucks, but they do happen.
No, listen. If you were to ask anyone, I don't think anyone expected this to really be a boring fight like this. Maybe you could see lulls in it.
Adesanya is really not a boring fighter.
Exactly. Adesanya is not a boring fighter. And Yoel Romero is not entirely a boring fighter either. More people go in on him and it would get caught. But he's very explosive. He can do a lot of things. You see more from him. This is just weird.
Do you think we ever see a rematch, or is this the one and done
because it was so bad? No way in hell we're seeing a rematch. Israel Adesanya is going to go against Paulo Costa next. That should be a lot better. Costa's going to go at him.
I don't know, Dave. I don't know if I trust you anymore. You hurt me deep with this
dude,
one.
Dude, listen, man. I expected a lot more. I can trust
First
me. Next
cut
one.
Is the demon.
Costa knows. Costa fights aggressively. He knows what he is going to have to do to win. He's not going to do the same thing that Romero did. It's that simple.
We shall see.
Yeah.
We're going to move on now to people that know what it takes to try and win a championship. That's a lie, because a lot of these kids are young and never been to March Madness. But some of them have.
Some of the coaches do.
We're talking about the only time where college basketball becomes relevant. Yay! It's March. It is conference championship time, Dave. It is almost time for the NCAA basketball championship, where this is where I put in my public service announcement that I'm going to do every week. Matt Madness also occurs, NCAA wrestling, which I arguably think, if you're just a fan of sports, try and catch NCAA wrestling tournament. It is awesome. I think it's better than March Madness, but I digress. So we're going to look here, Dave. And we're kind of going to – nothing is set in stone yet. The conference tournaments are occurring. Very few teams are actually in. I think Winthrop won there, Seton Hall. I think we have a lot of regular season champions. We don't have any tournament champions completely yet, besides like Winthrop and I think another like team or two. Prairie View I think might be in.
Mm-hmm.
But we have a lot of teams that we know are in. We know the Kansas Jayhawks are in. We know Gonzaga's in. We know Baylor's in. We know certain teams are in. The Dayton Flyers are probably going to be a one seed, which is a huge story, and that's really cool. Dave, Have you been paying attention, really? Do you have anyone that you think is favorite, and do you have a sleeper right now?
I've been paying attention tentatively.
Okay.
Unfortunately, it gets tough for me to watch college basketball when some of these teams are playing teams that I don't care about. So, and you know, some of those games are really, some of those games are really good too, because you see big teams lose to smaller teams, and that's crazy to watch most times.
Yeah.
But it's hard to catch those. But I think Kansas is definitely the favorite right now. It's for most people. It's either Kansas or Zaga, but it's going to be Kansas.
Yep.
And the one I want to see is Dayton. Dayton's a fun story. Obi Toppin's insane. Mm-hmm. So I want to see them play really well. They're not a sleeper, but I just want to see them do really well in the tournament.
Yeah. My favorite, I'm probably with you. You know, I think Baylor might be able to regain some of their composure from earlier in the year.
Yeah.
Baylor has to be up there. Dave, my sleeper, and they really shouldn't be a sleeper because they're number two, and it's weird. Florida State is the best team in the ACC. They're better than UNC. They really are, and Florida State has been consistent all year. I can really see Florida State making some real noise in this tournament and maybe making a Final Four. They've been knocking on the door for years as a very good basketball team.
Oh, no doubt. When it comes to March Madness, it's called March Madness for a reason. Literally anything can happen. That's why everyone fills out a bracket, even if you haven't watched literally any college basketball, because you can still get a lot of them right. So you never know what's going to happen. There's so many teams in this top 25 that you could see at least advancing and maybe making some noise, maybe doing something that knocks a big team out. I mean, Seton Hall, Miles Powell is insane. So,
Jersey, baby.
Exactly.
We're definitely, once the brackets get solidified soon, we'll probably do, hopefully the games don't start by our next show, but if they don't, we'll probably kind of, I don't think we'll go through game by game, but we'll give our possible big time upsets. We'll give our possible, you know, sleepers. But we're going to talk about quickly. We have two New Jersey teams, Dave. Seton Hall's expected. Seton Hall's a fantastic program.
Yep.
Shavar Reynolds, Manchester's finest, playing some big minutes there over for Seton Hall. But we also have the school of New Jersey, the Rutgers Scarlet Knights, Dave. Projected on, I'm looking at the NBC Sports. I think it's Greg Oman, or Dave Oman. His thing, he has Rutgers as a 10. I think he's out of his damn mind. Their slippage, they're going dancing, definitely. 20 wins is nothing to scoff at. They have the best home record in the country at 18-1, which, Dave, would you have picked out that Rutgers are the best home record in the country?
No, not even close.
Big 10 schedule?
Not even close.
The toughest conference in college basketball right now, and Rutgers has the best home schedule.
Hey, man.
Bizarre. The only loss coming to Michigan, who has been up and down as a very good team this year. It's pretty crazy right now if you're a Rutgers fan.
Yeah, no, it's a lot of fun right now if you're a Rutgers fan. Unfortunately, I haven't been paying attention too much. The main things I've seen is from you and K-Doc in the group talking about Rutgers basketball.
Yeah, and it
seems like a great time right now.
Oh, it's so good. And, you know, to see earlier this year, their best player, Geo Baker, was hurt. And they just went on a run, and now Gio's come back, and Gio's healthy. And he powered them. They got their second road win to solidify their seat in the dance against Purdue, who is also knocking on the door of a tournament team. They might be the first four out. And it was Geo Baker time. He made so many big shots, and that's what they're going to need. And now Rutgers can play the Big Ten tournament very loose, and if they make some noise in the tournament, can get a much nicer seed.
Yeah.
It's going to be interesting to see what they do. I'm not picking Rutgers for an Elite Eight team. I would love that, but Seton Hall is a better chance of being an Elite Eight team than Rutgers. But, man.
You got to have a bracket with them going now.
Oh, I'm going to have a bracket with you Rutgers have winning a bracket it. You kidding me? Going,
exactly.
I'm going to have a Rutgers winning bracket.
You got to have a fantastic, bracket. Amazing bracket.
Who's going to predict that? There'll be like 8,000 people from New Jersey for having a Rutgers championship bracket. Yeah. Nobody else. And 95% of their families are the players. But it's just cool to have two New Jersey teams in there representing. And it's a rare occasion, but honestly, the way Rutgers is built, looks like they're here to stay, Dave. That
they might be.
Is going to be huge.
They might be. You have a year like this, it gets tough to go backwards. You don't want to, especially with the fans.
This is where being in the Big Ten really helps. Mm-hmm. The Big East wasn't fantastic in terms of they. But don't get me wrong. The Big East was the power conference for basketball for many a years, but not this Big East. Not the Big East that Seton Hall just claimed. And Seton Hall's a great team. But this Big East is not your dad's Big East. It's a powerful conference, but it's not the conference. Rutgers is in the conference for college basketball right now, Big Ten. Made noise, and their recruiting pipeline is massive. I forget who I talked to about Rutgers sports, but football is the only sport really lagging behind now for in terms of Big Ten. Every other team in Rutgers is acclimated, and their recruiting has acclimated to it. We're in for a fun time as Rutgers fans, Dave.
Yeah, no, it should be a great time, and it's good to see Rutgers do good things again. It's been a while.
It's been a very long time, so go Rutgers. I hope Rutgers wins everything.
Win it all, Rutgers. Win that it would all. Be a story. You want to talk about a March Madness, that would
if
be
Rutgers
one.
Rutgers wins, you know, it's not going to happen, but...
No, it's not.
If Rutgers wins the national championship, Dave, the Jets don't have to win anything and neither do the Nets. Like, I'd be really
No, that's
happy.
False. I'd be happy, but no, I want them to win. Listen,
Kyrie could walk off his flat earth if Rutgers wins the national championship.
Listen, the curse that Joe has inflicted on his favorite teams may have been finally lifted with the Guardians going on a slight winning streak. We cannot waste this opportunity.
Big test with the Guardians against the Houston Roughnecks this week.
They're probably going to lose, but
hey, listen, we want to have a good game. Lou Perez is balling.
He is.
That dude's playing football. He's playing real football. He looks very good.
I hope he's playing
and the Roughnecks are human. They just score a lot. They give up, but that defense is terrible.
Oh, no, they're 100% human. You just have to try to stop P.J. Walker. Have fun with that.
Just hit him, hit him, hit him. It's the best way to get a quarterback's off their game. You hit him, which he's hard to hit. You
most
hit
quarterbacks,
him.
Yeah.
You can't hit him. He's slippery. Yeah. I'm telling you right now, P.J. Walker's a starting quarterback in the NFL next year for some team.
We'll see. I heard that Seahawks are looking at him for a backup, possibly.
See, if I'm him, I would go to the Browns when they give up on
They're not going to give up on Baker Mayfield.
They're going to give up on Baker Mayfield.
They're not going to give up on
Cleveland, David. They give up on everyone. Jim Brown could time machine back in prime shape, get 2,000 yards in a season, and he'll get booed.
They're not. They're not going to give up on Baker Mayfield.
They're giving up on Baker. Baker doesn't have a 25-10 year with at least 8-9 wins. Baker Mayfield's out the door. 25 touchdowns, 10 stop. Picks. Needs to get in playoff contention or wild card, or he is out the door in Cleveland.
No.
He's Johnny Manziel without the drinking problem if he doesn't do that.
That's
what he's going to be labeled as.
That's insane.
The comparisons are already there with him because he's cocky.
That's because they're stupid. That's and the dumbest comparisons I've ever seen in my life.
And because he didn't win this year.
It doesn't matter.
Telling you right now, P.J. Walker, new starting quarterback, Cleveland Browns. You heard it here.
Okay. The boldest. The boldest of takes.
The boldest. And he'll go 11-5 with them.
Okay.
And he'll unseat Patty Mahomes as the MVP. 6,000 yards. There you go. P.J. Walker.
Stop.
I don't even like the Roughnecks. I'm a Guardians fan.
Stop it. All right. Let me off this wild ride.
Get too goofy, we are going to close out this podcast. Dave, I had fun. Any last words, any fights to promote that are going to be disappointing?
I mean, I don't want to know.
The
next pay-per-view is Khabib versus Tony Ferguson. I think Tony Ferguson is really just getting offered up to a deity, but, you know, we'll see what happens. Tony's not a bad fighter, but Khabib's
This is Cowboy versus Conor all over again.
No, I wouldn't say that.
I'd say so. Most people against Khabib is Cowboy versus Conor.
He
outclasses everybody at this point.
He's terrifying. He's terrifying, and that's why I think it's really just an offering. But it's not like Tony's a bad fighter. I just don't see him winning.
Cowboy.
What?
Neither was Cowboy.
Cowboy's not a bad fighter. Cowboy's is really old.
I don't know. I just don't. And there's not many people at Khabib's level, anybody.
No, there isn't.
So.
But that's the next big fight. That's the next big thing. I don't know the rest of that card. There's probably other fights.
When is that fight? Is that fight this weekend, next weekend?
No.
Down the road?
April, I want to say.
April? You're going to plug the same fights till April?
No, I'm going to look at the fight nights in between.
Start watching Bellator or something, too. Give us something.
Stop.
Do it.
Now you're making me look this up. this is taking time. April 18th.
Yeah, there you go. April 18th.
That's the next pay-per-view, man. Yeah.
So that's a month and change.
Yeah, I'm just giving you the next pay-per-view.
All right. So with that, again, closing the show, Cuesta Dos, David Cuesta. That's my brother. Find him on Twitter at TheCuesta308. Instagram, Cuesta Cola. Find me on Twitter and Instagram at _Cuesta30. I'm Alex Cuesta, by the way. Find Sports Opinions on Twitter at SportsOpinion30. Instagram, SportsOpinions30. Go search for us on Facebook. And you can find this podcast anywhere you can find a podcast by just searching Sports Opinions Podcast. And underneath, you'll see Cuesta Dos. You'll see the Sports Opinions. You'll see We're Young But Just Us. You'll see us all. And just click on this one. And then all the others as well, because it's all awesome. So again, really appreciate everyone for listening. Have a good one, everybody.